Negative selection of bacterial colonies during DNA cloning. Sometimes we may want to use negative selection to identify bacterial colonies that contain our DNA of interest. This video builds on an earlier video that I made about positive selection, so if you haven't watched that one yet, click on this link to watch it before continuing on with this one. Just as a refresher, during negative selection, the bacteria that take up your DNA of interest die. Now, I know that this may sound counterintuitive, but as you will see, there is a very good reason why we might want to do this. Let's pretend that you have a DNA sequence of interest, shown in red, that you want to insert inside of a plasmid vector. We're going to assume that for this example, there are two convenient SOL1 restriction enzyme recognition sites that flank our DNA sequence of interest. Our plasmid vector contains two genes that we're interested in. One is the ampicillin resistance gene that allows E. coli to survive in the presence of ampicillin, and the other is the tetracyclin resistance gene, which allows E. coli to survive in the presence of tetracyclin. Both antibiotics will normally kill an E. coli cell. We also have restriction enzyme recognition sites where noted. Now, in order to insert your DNA of interest into the plasmid, you cut both with SOL1. Here we can see a magnified view of one of the cut sites. SOL1 recognizes the sequence GTC-GAC and leaves behind a 5' overhang. Here's a schematic of what our excised DNA may look like if the DNA of interest was successfully cut at both SOL1 sites. A similar process is occurring when we cut the plasmid with SOL1. Again, here is a magnified view. Again, SOL1 will cut at the same sequence, leaving behind a 5' overhang. Here is a schematic of what our plasmid cut with SOL1 might look like. If we looked inside our tube, we would see that we now have both our excised DNA of interest and our plasmid cut with SOL1. We want to ligate the two of them together. If we took a zoomed-in look, you would notice that our DNA of interest and your plasmid will have compatible ends. This will always happen when you cut both with the same restriction endonuclease. We could use different restriction enzymes in a more complicated setup, but I'll save that for another video. The process of inserting your DNA of interest into your plasmid is not a 100% efficient process. During this ligation procedure, several things can happen. It's possible that your plasmid anneals its ends together, resulting in the same plasmid sequence as before. It's also possible that your gene of interest is successfully inserted into your plasmid. If this happens, your DNA of interest is inserted smack in the middle of the tetracycline resistance gene, making it no longer functional. This is an example of insertional inactivation. The inactivation of a gene caused by the insertion of DNA within its coding sequence. This insertional inactivation will be very important for negative selection. While there are other possible things that could happen, for simplicity's sake, these will be the possibilities that we will be discussing. The end result of this process is that you will have some plasmids that do not contain your DNA of interest, and some that do. You then introduce the DNA into your host cell through transformation. Again, this process is not 100% efficient, resulting in three different possibilities. One, you could have E. coli that did not take up any DNA. Two, you can have E. coli that have taken up a plasmid that does not contain your DNA of interest. Or three, you have E. coli that have taken up a plasmid that does contain your DNA of interest. Ultimately, we want to find the bacteria that contain the plasmid with our DNA sequence of interest within it. But we cannot figure this out directly. The first thing we will do is to determine if our E. coli have successfully taken up a plasmid, regardless of if it has our DNA of interest or not. To do this, we plate our E. coli on a media that contains ampicillin. Why did we choose ampicillin? We use ampicillin to positively select for the E. coli that have taken up a plasmid. The bacteria that have not taken up a plasmid die due to the ampicillin. Those that have taken up a plasmid survive due to the presence of the ampicillin resistance gene. Now, we know that the surviving E. coli have taken up a plasmid. However, some of the surviving bacterial colonies will contain an empty plasmid, while others will have our DNA of interest inserted. We are interested in the colonies that have our DNA of interest, but at this point, it's impossible to tell the difference between the two of them. To solve this problem, we perform something known as replica plating. This involves taking the surviving bacterial colonies and spotting them on two brand new plates, but in a special way. Each spot on the original plate is placed on the two new plates in exactly the same relative position. A mark can be placed somewhere on the plate so that the relative positions on the plates can be determined. For example, I would take this spot on the original plate and transfer it to the first new plate at this position. I would then transfer the same spot from the original plate and transfer it to the same relative position on the second plate. I would then repeat this process for all of the surviving colonies on the original plate. The spots of the same relative position will be genetically identical to one another and will replicate a plasmid if it contains one. These two plates are different in one major respect. The first plate contains ampicillin, while the second plate contains both ampicillin and tetracycline. The plates are then incubated and the bacteria are allowed to grow. If the first plate contains only ampicillin, then all of the colonies from the original plate should survive, because we have already established that they have taken up a plasmid, and thus possess the ampicillin resistance gene. This plate serves as a control plate. The second plate, however, contains both ampicillin and tetracycline. Why would we use tetracycline in addition to ampicillin? Recall that if our gene of interest was successfully inserted into our plasmid, then we would have inactivated the tetracycline resistance gene. This would mean that the colonies that contain our DNA of interest will die on this plate. This is an example of negative selection, where the cells that contain our DNA of interest die. But all is not lost. We can see that the colonies here and here died. But remember that we performed replica plating. This means that we can go back to our control plate and find the colonies that are in the same relative positions as the dead colonies. These are the colonies here and here. These colonies, being genetically identical to the dead ones, will also contain the plasmid with our DNA of interest inserted within it. I hope this helps. Best of luck with studying. Please feel free to check out some of the earlier videos and leave a comment telling me what you would like me to create a video about next.